we'd like to begin this program and get this started for real. And I want to say thank you to all of you for coming. This is the eighth program that we've done jointly with JETRO. JETRO has been a pioneer in keeping open these economic channels through the years. I think in many ways it was JETRO's consistent presence that led us to this very important new space where we have the Trans-Pacific Partnership now is the positive agenda in both of our countries. This doesn't mean that it's smooth sailing from here. I think there's going to be a lot of hard work. But we know that we're on a path towards something very large and very important. And I would like to say congratulations and thank you to our JETRO friends for having brought this so far. And we're going to explore these issues in some depth today. It's going to be a full day, and we look forward to having all of you as active participants in it. But this morning, we're very fortunate that Senator Cardin is able to join us. I'll give you an advance warning. He has to depart here at 9:30 because there's a hearing that begins at 10 o'clock that he'll be chairing. Senator Cardin has a long and rich history in public service. Was first elected to the Senate. He'd been in the House of Representatives, first elected to the Senate in 2006, and was just reelected quite handsomely in the last election. And it reflects the very strong esteem that he's held in both by his constituents in the state of Maryland, but also by his colleagues in the Senate. He is genuinely one of the rising leaders that's reshaping the Senate, and we're glad for that. He has taken the responsibilities for the Asia Committee, Subcommittee, and that's a very important thing. He's going to be traveling soon to Asia and hopefully re-knitting the parliamentary exchanges that at one point were really the foundation of our relations with each other. He's a noted leader and a welcome leader on these very important issues at a time when both of our countries need to start defining an agenda of economic integration that's positive and prosperous for everyone in the region. So would you please, with your applause, thank and welcome Senator Benchard.
Bring that down a little bit there. Let me thank John Hamre for that leadership that you provide here at CSIS, and thank JETRO for its sponsorship of this forum. John is well known on Capitol Hill. As you know, he's a former Deputy Secretary of Defense and a Harvard Divinity graduate. I'm not sure how the two of those go together, but we didn't like to challenge his budget presentations when he was before Congress in those days, fear that the Almighty might take it out on us. But it's great to be here. And I thank you all for this topic, this seminar today, because I think it is critically important to talk about the Asia-Pacific economic integration and the U.S.-Japan relations. And as John pointed out, I'm honored to be the chair of the subcommittee for East Asia and the Pacific, particularly at this time. And that's why I think this seminar is particularly important as the Obama administration is implementing their rebalanced Asia policy, which I think is critically important to the United States and I think to the entire security of the Asian region. When you look at the importance of Asia to the United States and to the world, it's 1/4 of the global GDP. In the next 5 years, when we look at the economic growth outside of the United States, it represents 50% of the growth outside of the United States, the world's most prosperous and populous democracies, as well as the world's most authoritarian regimes. So it presents a real challenge for U.S. policy. We are, of course, now confronted with a commitment we have for nuclear free Korea Peninsula and the challenges presented by North Korea. We have the challenges presented on our environmental agenda, or on climate change. Those of us in the United States have recently experienced the wrath of weather, knowing full well that we have a commitment to work with Asia on dealing with environmental issues. But clearly in the headlines, most recently has been the challenges of North Korea and how do we deal with those challenges. And, of course, China's reaction to America's rebalancing to Asia is interesting. They are somewhat concerned about the troop movements that have been suggested in that region. But on the other hand, I think they share our concern about the security on the Korean Peninsula. And they certainly are a major competitor of the United States economically, which can be a very healthy situation for both countries. When we look at Japan, Japan is key to the U.S. rebalancing in Asia. There's no question about that. I know Prime Minister Abe, when he was here 3 months ago before you, declared that Japan is back. And Secretary Clinton said Japan is the cornerstone to our engagement in the Asia Pacific. And I agree with the former Secretary of State. U.S.-Japan relations are strong, two of the world's three largest economies, U.S. second largest source of imports, Japan's second largest source of foreign direct investment, Japan's second largest foreign holder of U.S. treasuries. I mean, I could go on, the list goes on and on and on about how important Japan is to the United States and how important the United States is to Japan. So economic integration must be part of a broader agenda. And that's one point I want to bring up. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I am the Senate chair, now the full chair of the U.S. Helsinki Commission. I've spent a good deal of my time in Congress working on human rights issues in Europe and Central Asia. And to me, the security agenda represented by the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe is a model for the world, and that is, you can't have economic security unless you have good governance and human rights respect. And you can have the strongest military in the world, you're not going to be a secure nation unless you deal with the human rights of your citizens and the economic prosperity of your citizens. Look at President Mubarak in Egypt and what his security meant for him without the security of human rights and economic growth. North Korea cannot survive without with the way that it is dealing with the economic growth of its citizens and the human rights of its citizens. So that when you look at an economic integration, you need to look at it in context to a security agenda, which includes good governance and also includes how a country respects the rights of its own citizens. When you look at the Asia region, how can you have economic growth if you don't deal with the maritime trade issues and the maritime security issues? And when you look at trading partners, how can they work under the threat of a nuclear North Korea? And what is the long-term stability of countries in Asia if they can't deal with the good governance issues that is problematic in so many of the Asian countries? That is why the subcommittee that I chair has had a scheduled two hearings already, and we have conducted, and we have a series more to deal with each of these issues. The first hearing that we had in our subcommittee dealt with human rights, transparency, good governance, and democracy. We looked at Southeast Asia. We looked at China. We looked at the rights of opposition and the open, fair press, the right to freedom of speech, the right to assemble, the right to challenge your government, the right to free and fair elections. And we will concentrate on those issues under my chairmanship of the subcommittee. Our second hearing dealt with security and defense issues. And yes, we did look at North Korea. And we are committed to the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Here's the challenge for the United States on the security and defense agenda. We're going to defend our friends. We will. We have treaties and we have obligations that we will adhere to protect our friends in Asia. But we want to do this in a way without the use of active military. Can we do this through a peaceful way? Well, we know that we have serious issues in Asia on maritime security. And as I was talking before I came up here, I need a roadmap to figure out all the different problems with the different countries. You know, a lot of them are our friends. They're having problems among themselves. We understand that. But maritime security is critically important to economic integration. Can't have economic integration without maritime security. So we need to resolve these issues. And the hearing that we had
was very clear about that. We need to do that in a peaceful manner. And there's some promise out there, some opportunities of joint economic ventures between the stakeholders, the countries, where they can share the resources of the region in a way that can benefit both countries that are claiming the territories involved. So the United States have plans to be very active on the maritime issues. Let me mention an area that is of tremendous interest to the Congress, and that is cybersecurity. We welcomed the informal working group that was set up between China and the United States on cybersecurity issues. That represents, I think, a step forward. But I must tell you, we know that there are cyber criminals out there that are victimizing America, which sourced from Asia, and we are concerned about those cyber criminals. There are cyber terrorists that are out there that want to cause significant problems to America. And yes, there are countries in Asia that sponsor cyber attacks against the United States, and we take that very seriously. So the cybersecurity issues will be paramount in our discussion. So as we look at the issues of military security and economic integration, these issues will become very, very important to the United States. The third hearing that our subcommittee will hold will be on energy and the environment. There's a lot we have in common here to talk about as to how we're going to deal with the challenges of the environment, how we're going to deal with climate change, responsibly dealing with the problems of developing countries and the developed world, how we're going to deal with food security issues. That's a major priority for the Obama administration, land rights. So there's a full agenda there. We will then get to the hearing that probably will be of most interest to the people that are in this room, and that is the economic landscape. And clearly, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, is our greatest promise for strengthening the economic ties between Asia and America. The TPP represents an opportunity to expand dramatically economic activities in the region, as well as benefiting the specific countries involved. We will be looking at investment opportunity within Asia and looking at gender equity issues, women empowerment, a huge priority for the Obama administration and for the subcommittee that I chair. You'll be hearing a great deal about gender equity issues. The U.S.-Japan ties are strong. And when you look at TPP, to me, the key here is how the United States and Japan provide the leadership necessary to get TPP to the finish lines. For 53 years, we've had a treaty of mutual cooperation and security. Japan has been a key partner of the United States in many of its global commitments. We particularly appreciate its support on our policies with Iran. That's challenging for a country that is strapped energy-wise to be able to help the United States in supporting the isolation of the Iranian regime. And, of course, we had the forward deployment of 49,000 U.S. troops. The closeness of our relationship, I think, was tested on Okinawa. And the fact that we were able to come up with the April agreement in such, I think, harmonious way showed that the United States and Japan both recognized the geographical changes that are taking place in Japan, recognizing that we had to redeploy some troops. The use of Guam and Hawaii provide that opportunity for us, and we were able to, I think, work out a framework that will be beneficial to both countries. And as you know, the Fukushima disaster, which was horrible for Japan, the U.S. response gained a great deal, I think, of public relations gain for the United States during that crisis. So we're in pretty good position right now. Japan and the United States, close allies, close friends, to provide the leadership necessary to marshal the economic integration in Asia. And that's what we will be doing with the Trans-Pacific Partnership. 11 participating states. At least now there are 11. That number could change, could grow, could shrink. We certainly hope that it will grow. There has been a great deal of progress between the United States and Japan on areas that
have been traditional barriers in trade between the two countries, in dealing with the auto sector, in dealing with agriculture, in dealing with the service industries. They're the hot-button areas that the United States and Japan need to resolve, and significant progress has been made on each of those fronts. I'm very impressed by the political leadership in Japan and the manner in which they've handled TPP. They're doing it openly and directly and before parliamentary elections. That's more courage than I see sometimes in U.S. politics. So I applaud them in the manner in which they are handling very openly the need for concessions to be made and markets to be opened. And that's the purpose. The purpose is to open markets, not to protect markets for both all the participating countries. I will be visiting, as John pointed out, Japan later this month, and we'll use that opportunity in an effort to try to advance the understanding between our two countries and the role that we have to play in advancing these economic agreements. And I will be spending some time with parliamentarians because I do believe that the exchanges between parliamentarians, we understand politics, and we understand what reality can be done and can help make this possible. The challenge on TPP is you're dealing with countries from Australia to Vietnam, from Malaysia to Peru. That's not easy to figure out a trade agreement that fits all those issues. And obviously there are many, many specific matters that need to be negotiated, from intellectual property to government procurement and subsidies, individual industries from textiles to dairy to pharmaceutical, and they differ by country, and each one need to fit into an overall framework, which makes it a challenge for the negotiators. Now, let me back up a little bit and let you know again about how I want to see this trade bill move forward by advancing areas that have been difficult for us to make progress. I think you all are aware that one of the priorities from the Democratic Party position in trade agreements has been to advance labor and environment. And I will continue to push on the labor and environmental front. And I think with TPP, there is good chance that the labor provisions are going to be pretty strong. And we will also work on the environmental side to make sure that those countries comply with international standards. But I also will be pushing for progress to be made in good governance and human rights. For those of you who are familiar with my track record on human rights, you will know that when Congress was challenged to pass the PNTR for Russia for its entry into the World Trade Organization, that I offered an amendment to that bill that included the Magnitsky Act. Sergei Magnitsky was a young attorney 3 years ago representing a U.S. client. Discovered the largest corruption scheme, governmental corruption scheme in Russia, and did what any lawyer should do. He reported it to the authorities. After all, he looked at the Russia constitution and law, and it said, this is illegal. Take action. Protect my client. Protect our country. And Sergei Magnitsky was investigated by the same people who his charges were against. He was arrested, tortured, denied medical care, tortured again, and died in prison. The people who perpetrated the crime against him were not held accountable, in fact, were promoted. So the legislation that I introduced that was signed by President Obama said that those who are responsible can't convert their rubles into dollars and can't visit their properties here in the United States. They can't get the fruits of their corruption, at least in the United States. Other countries are following suit. I mention that because it points out that we stand for something as a nation. And yes, we want to do business with Russia. We want to do business with the TPP countries. But they have a responsibility to meet international standards, not U.S. standards, international standards for good governance and human rights. And we will be pushing that. And I understand, this is a challenge when you look at the countries that are in the TPP, countries that are very advanced on good governance, and countries that are struggling.
I'm going to mention two of the Asian countries, but I can mention every country that has challenges in human rights, including the United States, I might add. But in Vietnam, it continues to harass, intimidate, arrest, and suppress bloggers and online activists using Article 88 that prohibits conducting propaganda against the state. Recently, Nguyen Van Hai, sentenced to 12 years in prison. Tha Phong Thanh, 10 years in prison. Phan Thanh Hai, 4 years in prison for blogging. And by the way, my staff gave me a long list of activists who are in prison in Vietnam today for doing nothing other than expressing their concerns about the governance of their country. I could mention Malaysia and the problems that they're having. That's a pretty advanced democracy, and yet NGO freedom is subject to unreasonable restrictions, and the opposition doesn't have all the rights that they need. And there's countries in the Western Hemisphere that I could easily mention that are challenged by human rights that are TPP countries. My point is this. Yes, economic integration is critically important by the passage of TPP. But suit manufacturer and shirt manufacturer located in my state, and they're very concerned about rule of origin issues. So therefore, this senator will be talking about the provisions related to rule of origin. Now, you multiply that times 100, and you got to deal with each of these concerns that will be expressed as we move forward, which brings me, of course, to a major issue, and that is, how do you get TPP without TPA? Trade Promotional Authority, Fast Track. Look, I serve in the United States Senate. By the way, it's really nice to be here. And, John, I might see if I can stay all day rather than have to go back to what I'm sure is going to be the problems on the floor of the United States Senate. But without Fast Track, how does any bill get off the floor of the United States Senate as complicated as a trade bill? The answer is unlikely. Yeah, the administration will need to have fast-track authority in order to be able to successfully complete the ratification of these agreements. Now, we have an October 2013 deadline on negotiations. That's pretty ambitious. How do you do that without trade promotional authority? I know it's a challenge. And we, of course, don't have a confirmed USTR yet. I expect that will be shortly. But without a trade representative that has the authority to negotiate, it's also going to be difficult to see us meet these deadlines. And then, of course, there's the scope that I've already mentioned, labor, environment, human rights. So this will be a challenge, but it is extremely important to get to the finish line. Extremely important. The U.S. Interest is for us to succeed in full integration on the economic front with Asia, including the TPP. It's clearly in our economic interest to succeed. Six decades ago, many people questioned whether the United States should be making the type of investments in Japan and Korea that we made 60 years ago. Those investments were in the U.S. interest. As we see today, two strong allies and economic partners and partners on so many fronts that help the United States and help our strategic interests. Well, that type of investment, that type of economic integration needs to take place now throughout Asia. And TPP offers us an opportunity to expand it to the Pacific, and we should take advantage of that opportunity, but it must be done in the right way, which brings me back to this forum and the people that are in this room. As I look around and see the type of leaders that are here, I urge you to be mindful of the various issues involved in economic integration, and let us figure out a pragmatic but yet fair way to move forward
to accomplish our mutual objectives that will advance the interest of the United States and the countries of Asia. That's our goal. That's what I plan to do as chairman of the subcommittee. And again, thank you all for your attention on this extremely important subject.
I'm Mike Green from CSIS. On behalf of CSIS and everyone in the audience, I want to thank Senator Cardin for his leadership on Asia and for laying out two important things everyone should know. Leaders in the Senate are committed to moving this forward, and there are a lot of issues that are going to have to be dealt with. And I thought this was one of the most impressive and clear pictures of.
Thank you for your leadership. You've testified before the Senate, and we appreciate very much your expertise. We're proud that you're a Marylander. I thank you for mentioning Marco Rubio, because the two of us have met frequently. Our staffs meet daily to make sure that we maintain that strong bipartisan support for the policies of the United States in Asia. And I expect that will be, you'll see that continue. During this Congress. Trade Promotional Authority and Fast Track envision a very close relationship between the Congress and the administration. So it doesn't mean, Trade Promotional Authority doesn't mean that the White House has the power to negotiate agreements and ignore Congress, and then it's just an up or down vote in Congress. That's what the law provides. As I think you are aware, trade actually, policy is actually the responsibility of the legislative branch, not the executive branch. We delegate that to the executive branch because we can't negotiate. We need the executive branch to negotiate for us. But we expect them to work with our concerns. So at every part of the process, there is required consultation. And this consultation is more than just listening to our concerns. The administration, and whether it's Democrat or Republican administration, has traditionally tried to follow the wisdom of the Congress in negotiating specific parts of the agreement. We then have what's known as a non-markup markup. So we actually will mark up the legislation before the administration even submits it to us, which gives us a chance to change it, not necessarily change the agreement, but to work with the administration to make sure that the intentions of Congress are carried out in the agreement. So there's a very close relationship here, and that's why we feel very comfortable under Trade Promotional Authority that Congress's views will be respected. We acknowledge that you can't, at the end of the day, take one part of a trade agreement out and isolate it, because that's not how you negotiate. You have to negotiate a final agreement. So it's something that ultimately will be passed. We will give the authority to the administration to negotiate. They need to have that on a multilateral agreement. Sometimes you can do a bilateral without Trade Promotional Authority. But on a complicated agreement involving these 11 countries, ultimately the Congress will need to give authority to the administration.
Thank you. I see a question in the way back. Are our microphone good? Could you briefly identify yourself, and then we'd ask the questions to also be brief. Thanks.
Sure. Hi. Joe Battisalli, I'm actually also a constituent. And
well, we planned that. We're only recognizing Marylanders right now. We'll get to non-Marylanders soon.
It's a conspiracy. I actually also had a question about TPA, because what you're describing is actually radically different than how TPA has worked in the past. And in reality, TPA is not required to get a trade deal through, as you saw during Colombia, Korea, and Panama. So I'm not sure what you mean when you say it's necessary, and I'd really like a direct answer on this.
Why it's necessary?
Yeah, because it's clearly not, because we just got three trade deals without it.
I think it would be extremely difficult to get negotiations done with 11 countries where they're sitting around a table negotiating back and forth, and for the United States to say, oh, by the way, whatever we negotiate is subject to further negotiations by the Congress. I just don't think you can get that type of an agreement negotiated in a fair manner. I just don't think it will happen. So I just take exception with you. In the three agreements you talked about, there were no changes made by Congress. So I'm not sure where you are referring to on those agreements.
Charles?
Quickly, as a follow-up, as you're my representative, it's your responsibility to be part and active in this trade agreement, and you're delegating that authority.
Right.
And that's my major concern. Whether you have a change at the end or not, you giving up that authority is not why I sent you there.
Well, we're going to disagree on that, okay? I understand your position. Look, I voted for and against trade agreements, and I'm going to continue to exercise my independent judgment. However, I don't believe that Congress can negotiate a trade agreement. I think the administration should negotiate a trade agreement. I think that the administration must work with Congress as that agreement is negotiated. And in a way, Congress has a veto as that negotiation is going forward. And we've exercised that. There are many provisions in trade agreements that are there or not there because of Congress in part of the negotiations. There is a very close relationship. But to suggest that at the end of the day that a trade agreement should be open to amendment, and then you have to go back to the other 10 countries to try to get ratification of the change because of changes made in Congress, to me, that's not how a multinational trade agreement should be completed, and that the administration should have that responsibility. Congress has the responsibility up or down. We don't have to approve it. So if the administration doesn't follow our lead, we'll vote against it, and it's very possible that could happen.
Thank you. It's like a town hall meeting. It's great. Charles Freeman, up front.
I want to say one other thing on trade. Believe me, I have voted against TPA, and what I want to see is broad authority to the administration in TPA to be able to cover beyond. Traditionally, we went into tariff negotiations. And then okay, we understood there were non-tariff issues that the administration had to have authority. We went through NAFTA, and we couldn't get authority to deal directly with labor and environment. And that was a mistake. We've now put labor and environment in the core agreements. That's an improvement. I want to see good governance there. So I will be fighting that in the trade promotional authority that the administration has, that there's expectation that they'll go beyond the traditional safe areas that the United States has negotiated.
Thank you. Charles Freeman from PepsiCo. I want to thank Senator Cardin for all you do for the great state of Maryland.
You still can move into the state. It'd be nice.
I move in, I move out. Just a quick aside, as a former negotiator, for USTR, we spent significantly more time with members of Congress than we actually do the groups with whom we're negotiating. So I feel quite confident that members of Congress have that input. And I just, as a correction, the three trade agreements that were passed subject to a grandfathering of TPA. So they were not separate and distinct. But I want to, speaking on behalf of the business community, we have not been engaged, particularly by the administration, on either TPP, although we're starting to get interested, or TPA. And I guess from your standpoint, how would you advise us to be more engaged and more supportive to help? help both Congress get comfortable with TPA and TPP and push the thing forward.
It's an excellent point. It's you're right. We have not been visited. I mean, I don't know if that's good or bad. I don't think there is much expectation that there's going to be early congressional action on trade. Now, I don't know the timing that the administration has on trying to complete the negotiations or sending up a trade promotion authority. And we don't have a USTR yet. My guess is that decision will be made shortly, and the business community has to be actively engaged. I just put on the other side, and that is the labor community. We've had trade agreements where labor has been divided. We've had trade agreements where labor has been unified in opposition. We need to have a very open process. So before this gets in stone, it'd be nice to know what needs to be in the agreement to get the type of support necessary to get this passed. And that is part of the consultation and negotiating process. I mentioned congressional roles. There's also sector roles. As you know, they have sector groups that work to make the textiles will be a very challenging issue and the rule of origin. I mentioned it for Maryland, but it's beyond Maryland. So that issue needs to be resolved between the industry, labor, and members at an early possible time so we don't go down a path that locks in significant opposition to the bill, making it difficult to pass. That has to be done in dairy. That has to be done in autos. There's so many different sectors that it has to be done in. And the sooner the administration engages the stakeholders, the better.
Glenn, in the middle.
My name is Glenn Fukushima. I'm with the Center for American Progress. I used to work at USTR back in the 80s on Japan and China, and recently returned to Washington, D.C. after working in Tokyo for 22 years. Senator, based on your comments, I infer that you are in support of the administration's Asia pivot or rebalance.
Yes.
I've been a bit confused after coming back to Washington as to what exactly we could expect over the next 4 years on this, because there have been many speeches, many articles that have appeared, the economic aspects, the military aspects, and so forth. But I think there's some question, certainly here in town, but also in Asia, as to what exactly we can expect. How much real engagement with Asia, given all the other things that are going around in the world and given limited resources and so forth, in financial terms and in personnel terms. From your perspective, being in the Senate as one of the leaders working on East Asia, what do you expect and what can we realistically expect in terms of the engagement of the United States in Asia beyond just TPP over the next 4 years? Thank you.
First, I think you'll find more political time spent on Asia than we have in the past. The president will be in Asia more than he has in the past. He already has made a strong commitment to his own personal time in Asia. You'll see by the budget that he submitted. He submitted a larger increase in the support for the Asian efforts than in other sectors of the world. So we're putting more resources, whether it's USAID, whether it is diplomacy, or whether it's military. There has been an increased focus on strengthening our presence in Asia. We are working on new military arrangements, which has China somewhat concerned. Those new military arrangements are meant to provide more security to our partners in Asia. And again, we want to do this in a peaceful manner. So you'll see that. I think you're going to find just greater amount of attention and politics and resources placed in Asia. We will be strengthening our economic ties. The TPP represents that. It's just one part of that. But I think you'll find a much closer economic relationship between the United States and Asia. As you know, America has focused more on its own hemisphere in Europe. We're now going to be focusing more on Asia. And I would expect more on Africa, to tell you the truth. I think that also will see a significant increase in U.S. Interest in Africa. So you'll see more exchanges. We already do a significant number of exchanges with students and business leaders. I think you're going to see those numbers increase dramatically in the next several years. So I think it's all of the above.
We also are looking at training more people, more expertise in Asia. So it will affect our universities. It will affect throughout our country to try to get a better literacy in America on Asia. So I think all that's healthy and will reflect the reality that Asia is much more significant today than it was 50 years ago in world events.
Senator, could I close by asking a question about the future of TPP, which is hard enough. This makes it harder. China is in APEC, is obviously not in TPP.
Separate challenge for the United States, and we need to deal with our bilateral with China probably more than dealing with a regional issue with China, and some of it deals with the currency issues, some of it deals with intellectual property. There will come a time that China will recognize that they need to develop a greater internal capacity for innovation and creativity, and that a more open society will give them that opportunity. They have some fundamental problems. They're making progress, don't get me wrong. They are making progress, but they still do not have a society that allows for the innovation that they need in order to meet their future. That's a fundamental problem of the country. What our objective will be is to try to get China on a path that is a more open society. There's a reason why we had normal trade relations with certain countries and not with others is the type of country that they are. I understand we have normal trade relations with China today. They're a giant as far as the economy is concerned, but they still allow the Communist Party to dictate too much of their economic activities. That has to change in China. So I think you're going to find a concentration by the United States to continue China down a path of more openness, a more open market, certainly less currency manipulation, much more protection for intellectual property, much more personal freedom, internet freedom, et cetera. And when that progress is made, it will also open up China to regional agreements such as a TPP.
We really appreciate you joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
I'm not a Marylander. I used to live in New Haven, Connecticut, long time ago, 30 years ago. I look young, but not young at all. Thank you, Mike, for your kind introduction. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Hiroyuki Ishige, Chairman and CEO of JETRO. I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to all of you here for joining us today. Let me also extend my deepest appreciation to ambassadors, U.S. government officials, and the business leaders. I would also like to thank Dr. Hamre and Dr. Green, as well as their colleagues at the CSIS for their dedicated work. JETRO has held this annual seminar here in Washington, D.C. since 2004. And today's seminar is the eighth in cooperation with the CSIS. As you are aware, Japan has decided to take part in TPP negotiations, making the timing of this seminar most auspicious. Japan's decision is significant in that its participation would expand the economic coverage of the TPP from the current 30% to 40% of the world GDP. Yesterday, I met quite a few number of US business people here. All of them welcomed Japan's decision. Yes, Japan's participation increases the value, business value of the TPP, provide the business opportunities. However, I think it is also significant in another way. Japan's participation in the TPP negotiations will not only strengthen the TPP, but also stimulate other mega FTAs, namely the EU-Japan EPA, TTIP, I have just learned how to call it, and the RCEP. These four will drive the development of future global rules of trade and investment, even the stagnation of WTO talks. This world map illustrates the four mega FTAs and four major economic powers supporting them. I strongly feel they represent a new era across the Pacific, the Atlantic, and Eurasia. So we have to change the title next year. I think that to cover from the stagnant WTO Doha round, further promotion of these four mega FTAs towards realizing liberalization of trade and investment is essential. To achieve this goal, the US and Japan should take the lead. This is my core message. I'll explain why in detail. This slide shows the schedule of recent negotiations for mega FTAs. The negotiation in 2012 was centered on the TPP alone. However, in 2013, negotiations of two other FTAs, RCEP and the EU-Japan EPA, have already started, and negotiations of all four mega FTAs will be in progress before summer. This indicates that the trend towards mega FTAs has accelerated across the globe. With this acceleration, what form should economic integration in the Asia-Pacific take in the future? I think that in order to facilitate global liberalization of trade and investment, establishing advanced rules with an extensive economic coverage will be required in this region, a growth center in the world. To achieve this goal, it is essential for us to create, maintain, and accelerate an environment across the world which could be described as global competition towards liberalization through regional economic integration. To realize an economic integration framework in the Asia-Pacific region, the TPP and RCEP will function as the dual wheels of the scheme. The TPP as an innovation function aiming at an advanced agreement suitable for the 21st century. The RCEP as a function to improve the regional economy by including lesser developed countries such as Myanmar, Cambodia, and Laos. These two are mutually complementary. They should inspire each other and play their respective roles. I think you are already familiar with TPP itself. Here, I would like to touch upon how other countries have responded to Japan's decision to participate in the negotiations. China and Singapore, for example, have shown strong interest in this announcement. In China, concerning a joint statement announced by the US and Japan on February 22nd in Washington, the People's Daily reported that America is bringing Japan to the negotiating table to deter China's influence. And in Singapore, I'm not saying this is China People's Channel Daily report. And in Singapore, the government stated that Japan's participation would have great implication for the development and stability of the Asia-Pacific region. It also claimed that the conclusion of both the TPP and the RCEP will bring us closer to realizing the so-called EFTA. Judging from the recent actions of other countries, I believe Prime Minister Abe's decision regarding participation can be seen as a potential game changer that will draw many more countries into the scheme. Japan's participation can in fact provide an impetus for ASEAN members such as Thailand and the Philippines to also join the negotiation on the TPP in the near future. I'd be very grateful if experts from China and Singapore attending this seminar could give us their perspectives on this issue. Next, I'd like to talk about the RCEP, the other key to realizing the FTAP initiative together with the TPP. The most major features of the RCEP are its wide economic coverage and growth potential, which distinguish this partnership from the present TPP. The RCEP accounts for half of the global population, or about 3.4 billion people, while the TPP accounts for only about 10%, or about 0.7 billion people. To maintain its extensive economic coverage, member countries in the RCEP are doing their best to set broader agendas. The RCEP's aim to be business-friendly demonstrates this perspective. By applying the so-called accumulation rule, this is the rules of origin rule, so I have to get the approval by the senator. The creation of the RCEP would help companies in members countries clear rules of origin with greater ease. Thanks to this rule, as well as the further liberalization of trade in services, the RCEP would also benefit these companies by giving them more options in choosing procurement sites and improving their supply chains. Because of this gradually progressive approach of the RCEP, I've heard that in the United States, this initiative is not necessarily considered as an important regional economic integration. RCEP doesn't seem to be popular in the United States, especially in this town. I do not share this diagnosis. The RCEP will move slowly but steadily. When I was a boy, my mother once told me, Hiroyuki, this is my first name, you are not very quick, but you are determined, slow and steady, win the race. This will be facilitated by the formation of the ASEAN Economic Community by 2015. I think the RCEP will eventually become a very comprehensive, competitive initiative for regional economic integration, again, which will be mutually complementary with the TPP. Finally, I would like to touch upon the roles of the United States and Japan in promoting trade liberalization through mega FTAs. Previously, the US, the EU, Canada, and Japan had played a prominent role in establishing global rules for trade and investment in the 20th century. As I mentioned at the beginning of my speech, in the 21st century, with its increasingly globalized supply chains, it will be the four mega FTAs that will play this role. In this new structure, what I refer to as the maybe new code consisting of the US, the EU, Japan, and China will assume major roles in promoting free trade as the core of these four regional integrations. The metrics in this slide describe the relationship of these countries and regions with each scheme. Japan is involved in three of the four, including the TPP, the US and the EU in two, respectively, and China in one. Looking at the economic scales of each scheme and country, which are also shown in the matrix, Japan is well aware of its responsibility as a bridging partner and of how vital the role of the US and Japan is in this new framework. In the beginning of my presentation, I emphasized the need for a competition towards liberalization among various regional integration schemes. However, if each of the four schemes, which together account for 80% of the global economy, moves independently in uncoordinated competition, it may adversely impact global trade and investment. How can we lead then to a coordinated competition? To accomplish this, I would like to propose a meeting of trade ministers or senior officials of major economic powers, including the US, the EU, Japan, and China, responsible for establishing a potential global trade and investment rules. Ministers will discuss what common elements those mega FTAs have and how they can be coordinated. Of course, the purpose of this meeting is not for negotiations, but mainly for transparency and information sharing or some coordination if necessary. Now, I will touch upon our relationship with China. The US and Japan will also play important roles in this regard. I think that participation in the TPP could be like a second accession to the WTO for China, in that it would provide great impetus for that internal transformation. This is essential for China's sustainable economic growth. The TPP focuses not only on removal of tariffs, but also abolition of subsidies for state-owned enterprises, enhancement of enforcement of rules for intellectual property rights, and for government procurement. These have been common issues for the US and Japan in doing business with China. The US and Japan have essential roles to play for the healthy economic growth of China under new trade and investment rules, as well as in the event it chooses to take part in the TPP. I believe that the US and Japan will sincerely welcome China overcoming these hurdles and joining the TPP, and China will reap great benefits in doing so. Just as with Korea, there are concerns about the political tension Japan is facing in relations with China. In spite of these difficulties, however, the three countries reached an agreement on starting a trilateral FTA last November in Cambodia. In addition, the leaders of 16 countries, also including Japan, China, and Korea, have agreed on the launch of negotiations for RCEP. Moreover, specific negotiations are in progress both in the Japan, China, Korea, FTA, and RCEP. I'd like to highlight the fact that the agreements on launching the negotiation were concluded despite the political difficulty surrounding them. According to media reports, the meeting of economic ministers from the three countries was realized thanks to a strong push by China. When looking at the Japanese islands from Beijing, one can see also glimpse the United States. One can also glimpse the United States forehead over the Pacific. Presumably, China made the decision because the focus of its gaze is on the United States rather than Japan in regard to the TPP. China is very enthusiastic about promoting the RCEP and the Japan-China-Korea trilateral FTA. Lastly, I would like to emphasize again that the relationship between the US and Japan, which share common fundamental values such as democracy, free trade, and the rule of law, is essential for promoting trade and investment in the Asia-Pacific region. In order to maintain the best global partnership between the US and Japan, communication between the two countries, strengthening mutual understanding, strengthening mutual confidence, and continuous network building are vital. Efforts like this have created our relationship trust, as exhibited in the results of opinion polls in this slide. 84.5% of Japanese feel familiarity with the United States, and 84% of Americans said they can trust Japan. In the international community, where developing countries are now rising, both the United States and Japan must now lead the way by spearheading the establishment of advanced international rules. Additionally, close cooperation between the both countries needs to be promoted in the real business world as well. If we look at the auto sector as an example, which has been an issue in US-Japan bilateral consultation on the TPP, we'd better keep in mind the fact that Japanese affiliated auto manufacturers produce 2/3 of their branded cars in the United States and began export to other countries. Thus, they contribute to the US economy as well as job creation here. We would, of course, be enthusiastic if US companies took advantage of Japan as a gateway to Asia for the expansion of their business in the region. This is all I have to say at this moment. The experts following me will offer valuable insights concerning economic integration in the Asia-Pacific region from a variety of perspectives. I hope for this seminar to be a most beneficial and meaningful experience for all of us. Thank you very much.
Question and challenge and quiz our experts. Then we'll have a lunch break, and we've invited Assistant USTR Wendy Cutler to be our luncheon speaker. We always put the USTR or US negotiator at the end so that you get a sense through the morning about how hard their job is and take a little pity on them. And Wendy's terrific looking forward.
here and make this presentation. Actually, according to my personal opinion, I think that Mr. Lin should be the first speaker. Yeah. But I'd like to thank the arrangement made by the organizer. It shows that they are very appreciating China's role in Asia-Pacific region. So this morning, I just like to talk about Asia-Pacific integration issues and excuse me, and conflicts among TPP members. Actually, in this region, I think that you know that facing with financial crisis and debt crisis, Asia-Pacific region already becomes more and more important for a global economic recovery as well as global economic growth. In this region, personally, I think that the changing and shaping pattern already gradually for integration in Asia-Pacific region gradually happened. Firstly, you can see that TPP already in progress, also have maybe 15 rounds negotiation. So that's why I regarded TPP is a first track in this region. Of course, the United States shows its westward strategy and return to Asia strategy. Meanwhile, Canada, Mexico, and Japan, those big economic entities in the region also involved in, shows that TPP is very attractive for the relative members in the region. Of course, the second track is also very important, especially for China. In East Asia, you can see that last year, China-Korea FTA negotiated maybe a few rounds already. And the CJK FTA, although China and Japan now has a very, very bad political relationship, but CJK FTA is still a kickoff. This is a very good signal. Of course, you know that regarding RCEP, yesterday evening, I said that in the near future, maybe RCEP would be a 10 plus 6. We cannot make sure in the future we will formulate it maybe 10 plus 6, 10 plus 5, or 10 plus 3. That will depend on the situation. Maybe some of country, they cannot access to this type of integration process. The third track I'd like to remind you is that last year in APEC meeting, environmental products list, you know that 54 environmental products can enjoy a zero tariff. That's a very important progress in the region. That means APEC don't die. At maybe APEC is still alive. Maybe in the this is a you know that environmental product list is a small seed. Maybe in the future this seed can grow very rapidly. I hope that the product list will be longer and longer. Meanwhile, other type of products also will be involved in. Lastly, Russia is implementing its eastward strategy. And maybe Russia will be the potential and new emerging track in this region because Russia started to negotiate the bilateral FTA with Vietnam as well as New Zealand. In the future, Russia has a very ambitious goal is that Russia will bring Kazakhstan as well as Belarus into Asia-Pacific region. And back to TPP issues, I think that, of course, United States is playing a leading role, because of high standard and wide range. Actually, if you look at NAFTA, if you look at those bilateral FTAs signed by US and other countries, environmental concerns, labor standard concerns already expressed in early stage. Actually, I chaired China-Peru, China-Chile bilateral a joint feasibility study, as well as China-Pakistan. When we negotiate FTA with Peru, I found that Peru side, as well as Chile side, they required to talking about environmental issues as well as labor standard issues. But at that time, you know that for Chinese side, we are just negotiating very traditional bilateral FTA. Started from China, Peru, and China, Chile. Also, Chinese side started to concern, considering how to integrate environmental issues as well as labor issues into FTA negotiation. But I think that for United States, actually, you know that because you are very eager to promote TPP, however, I'm afraid that you are ignoring the large economic gap and different national conditions of the members in the region. Also, I think that you have to, you know, notice that there are some of conflicts with the interests of different members. For Singapore, I think that because Singapore is a free port and very free economic entities, that means large-scale free trade agreement is in line with Singapore's development interests. Also, Singapore needs fine-tuning in this region. I'd like to remind you that actually Singapore, I think that Singapore has a very long-term strategic consideration because in 2005, Singapore is one of the initiative countries for TPP. Certainly, regarding Australia and New Zealand, you can see that, of course, these two countries are belonging to developed countries. They are very willing to promote free trade agreements. However, if you look at IPR issues, actually, there is you know, a disagree voice from, you know, Australia and New Zealand. For example, for between United States and Australia, actually, Australia says that TRIPS is enough for TPP. TRIPS is enough for, you know, US, Australia, FTA. However, United States says that we need to promote TRIPS plus. So that's a contradiction between US and Australia. Meanwhile, if you look at Vietnam and Malaysia, I think that this is a very difficult problem. You know that we often discuss why Vietnam can join TPP. How can Vietnam to join TPP? That's my concerns, but I didn't get any answer, a satisfied answer. Because you know that in my mind, 20 years ago, you know that a lot of Vietnam delegation came to China and to learn experiences of reform and opening up in China. And also, I had given my lecture to those Vietnam. SOE issues in Vietnam is more difficult than that in China. In China, a lot of SOE already have been reformed, becomes a listed corporation in Chinese stock market and in United States market, as well as in London. But I don't know what the situation in Vietnam. I heard that SOE is dominating Vietnam economy, and its reform it still take a long time. Of course, you know, regarding, you know, intellectual property protection issues, human rights and democracy issues, I do believe that Vietnam, they are facing with more and more difficulty. Of course, regarding Brunei, although it's an initial country for TPP, however, you know that regarding, you know, environmental protection, fishery subsidies, labor issues, IPR issues, Brunei already, you know, raised their requirements to the United States. United States need to provide capacity building and subsidies to Brunei. Chile and Peru may be better a little bit. However, regarding IPR issues, also, you know, there are some of, you know, concerns. Of course, Canada at the beginning, deep reform in dairy products is poultry, eggs, and other supply chain management policies. That's the biggest concern from Canada's side. For Mexico, IPR issues, also drug issues, medical issues, also I think that there are some of problems. So Also, we need to look at the, each potential TPP member. Also, they have their own consideration. Of course, in Japan, political turmoil, you are very familiar. And the reform of laws and regulations, including agriculture, fishery, intellectual property rights, especially insurance and the post services. Also, I'd like to say that at this stage, actually, Japan is facing this tough mission because Japan needs to negotiate TPP. Also, you need to negotiate with EU. Also, you need to negotiate with on the platform RCEP. That's the most, you know, most important mission. Compared with Japan, I think that ROK is quite, you know, positive in the past. They already finished their bilateral FTA negotiation with United States, with EU, with other members in Asia Pacific region. That's why today ROK it becomes relaxed a little bit. Of course, for ROK in this region, actually, they, you know, that to some extent they lack benefits, but more responsibility in this region. ROK said that we already have a lot of a series of bilateral FTA with those TPP negotiating members. in case that you know, the condition becomes matured, and then ROK, it's easier for ROK to join TPP. The problem is that ROK just, you know, is questioning the transparency of the negotiation process and the results. This is quite similar with China. And then next slides, I will talking about China's concerns. Meanwhile, you have to notice that Thailand and the Philippines also express their interest in, for TPP. However, for Thailand, seriously, they have their seriously weigh the pros and cons and not in haste to join the TPP negotiation. For Philippines, we think that the total situation is worse than that in Vietnam. In China, you know that actually regarding TPP, now we already formulated a lot of, you know, viewpoints and theories. Due to lack of transparency and information of TPP, in China, so a lot of scholars just, you know, guess and just, you know, what happened for TPP and what's contents, what's the directions and the trend of the TPP. And then they formulated a different, for me, I think that's a six type of misunderstanding, I concluded. The first is conspiracy viewpoints. That says that TPP is a conspiracy orchestrated by the US, aiming to limit and constrain China's, you know, development. This is a very typical, you know, viewpoints. I think that this type of viewpoints overestimated the IQ of the United States. Actually, United States is also a latecomer. Actually, P4 is, you know, initiative country of TPP. The second viewpoint, that is pessimism viewpoint. Some of scholars, they conducted so a lot of detailed calculation on TPP, East Asia FTA, CJK FTA, something like that. And then the conclusion is that, TPP will dominate the process of Asia-Pacific economic integration, and all East Asia cooperation mechanism will be disappeared. I don't agree with these viewpoints. And waiting viewpoints means that, come on, TPP is so far from us, a long distance, because so high standard. So what we can do is just waiting. So this is a, this is a wrong, you know, attitude. And the fourth one is disturbing viewpoint. That is, given that United States and Japan and other members didn't allow China to join TPP, that means we can make disturbing for this this progress. I said that for China, China is a big country. It's no need for China to disturb any, you know, trade and investment liberalization and the facilitation process. China will respect any, you know, mechanism and any platform in this region. The opposed viewpoints also, you know, that for some of scholars, they say that we can use CJK FTA against TPP. We can use RCEP to against the TPP. I say that definitely that's wrong viewpoints. Actually, you know that there is no any conflict between RCEP and TPP. They could be the parallel, you know, tracks in this region. The last one is dominant viewpoint. I don't agree you say that China will dominate RCEP, United States will dominate TPP, and Japan wants to dominate the 10 plus 6, something like that. You know, just due to this type of dominating viewpoints and those big economic poverties, they have their mistrust in this region. If you look at the EU, you can find that Britain, Germany, France belonging to big economic entities in that region. But they don't say that Great Britain will dominate the EU process, or France will dominate the integration process in EU. They are actually every country in this region, no matter big country or, you know, small country, they are equal. We need to negotiate. We need to sit in together. We need to cooperate. So I don't think that dominant is a good, you know, saying in this region. Lastly, I'd like to talk about how to improve, you know, transparency of TPP negotiation. Even if in the United States and in Canada, you know that some of voices, complaining voices from business circle, I heard. Because you know that for those businessmen, they said that actually we want to know what's the future trend and future directions for TPP negotiation, but we don't know. Because TPP has a negotiation, has a very strict information, you know, disclosure. Of course, for China, you know that at this time point, it's very urgent and it's very important for China to reform and open up further. Premier Li Keqiang said that in China now, you know that in the past, China was enjoying demographic dividend. But gradually in China, this type of dividend will be disappeared. In the next stage, maybe, you know, we can enjoy our reform dividend. That means, you know, we need to find the right direction of reform and opening up. Just before, you know, that Mr. Ishige already mentioned, actually, regional economic integration will be China's second time, you know, join WTO, this type of effect. And regional integration will provide the new driving force for China's reform and opening up. That means China needs to study trends, directions of TPP. We want to know what will be happened for TPP and what type of rules will be decided by TPP. So in this regard, I think that I suggest that maybe TPP negotiators can, you know, provide a good chance for China. Maybe, you know, that you can consider make China becomes a limited, you know, observer for TPP negotiation. I just like to say, for China, we don't want to know your, you know, negotiation secret, your price, you know, for TPP. However, we just want to know what's the directions, what's the trend, and what's the rules development trend. So that's very important for China. So we want to know the relative, you know, information. Also, that will make us to consider TPP right on the right way. Last point regarding RCEP, I also like to raise my concerns for this. You know that for 10 plus RCEP will based on 5, 10 plus 1. The problem is that for another, except 10 countries in ASEAN, another 6 countries, you didn't find, you know, any bilateral, there are like of some of bilateral or trilateral important FTA, such as the CJK, such as China-Australia, such as Japan-Australia, this type of FTA. If this type of bilateral or trilateral FTA will be the critical factor for RCEP, I don't know the answer. I hope to listen your opinion on that. The second question is that for RCEP, a lot of countries claim that RCEP also should be a high standard. But I like to say that high standard means that the process, negotiation process, will be very difficult, even if for TPP. I think that if TPP can provide a certain flexibility, that means TPP, it would be possible for TPP to make consensus. Also for RCEP, I think it's true. If you look at the SEPA between China and Hong Kong, you can find that at the beginning, we have a SEPA 1. Gradually, we upgraded SEPA to today already becomes SEPA 9. I think that's a very good model. Lastly, regarding flexibility issues, I think that for RCEP or for TPP negotiation, a few laws would be possible or also could be acceptable, especially for RCEP. Because you know that, for example, for India, I don't think that India could be, for India, it would be easier to negotiate FTA because in India, their manufacturing sector is quite weak. Just make GDP contribution 20%. So meanwhile, if you visit India, you can find that infrastructure is quite, quite bad. So for India, I think that there is a long way of industrialization and urbanization to go. So that's why that I don't think India could be a qualified negotiator for RCEP. But that's just my personal opinion, not on behalf of NDRC or my institute. So that's my viewpoint. So thank you for your attention. Thank you.
That was excellent, Dr. Zhang. Thank you. And we don't have a first-class prize, but if we did, you would win it. We, in the past, have usually...
treatment of developing countries, RCEP is likely to be very flexible, whereas TPP is not so flexible. Now, the impacts of TPP and RCEP on Japanese economy, according to the official estimate by the Japanese government, actually Japanese cabinet office, TPP would raise Japan's GDP by 0.66%. Although this may sound small, but we know Japanese economy is growing at like 1 or 2% at most, 0.66% is not so small. However, a study done by Peter Petrie and others for Peterson Institute came up with larger numbers. The difference is that the Petrie and others included a very interesting mechanism, such as, you know, entry and exit of companies, or so-called like dynamism into the model, whereas Japan's Cabinet Office estimate is done on a static level, very, you know, standard type. Again, Peter Petrie came up with larger number. Whichever the number is, it's clear that TPP and RCEP would contribute to Japan's economic growth. However, there's a strong opposition, particularly from the agriculture sector. They talk about the food security may not be achieved if we join TPP. Multifunctionality of agriculture will be damaged. But in my view, strongest opposition, or the reason for opposition, comes from this protection of vested interest. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but I can spend a lot of time. And you have to be, you have to take a risk if you do this kind of thing. Not only maybe in Japan, but other countries too. You get a lot of phone calls, you get nasty emails, and so on. But I still think this vested interest is the problem in Japan. And this shows the this diagram shows the level of protection for selected items in Japan. And I remember I used the same diagram last year. Although, you know, the numbers should change in my view, because you know, yen appreciation or depreciation, that will change the so-called differential in international price and domestic price. But Minister of Agriculture keeps using this diagram, and I just wondered why they do that. And if we compare rice price, international price, and domestic price, or producer's price, it's about 200%, 300%. It's not 788%. Again, this is my just a guess. Maybe agriculture ministry wants to tell the farmers that we are protecting you a lot. And if we remove this protection, 788%, then we'll have a disaster. And that's not true. As I told you, our rice prices, differential between international and domestic prices is much, much less. So all these propaganda, and that is really making negotiation very difficult. And finally, I'd like to end with my concluding remarks. I think Japan should contribute to quick conclusion of FTAs, not only RCEP, of course, TPP we are not in yet, but once we are in, we should contribute to the quick conclusion of TPP, CJK, China-Japan-Korea, Japan-EU, and so on, by maybe, as Ishige-san proposed, having this kind of informal or formal consultation among major stakeholders. That could be a very, I think, a useful forum to move negotiations forward. And then Japan should establish high-level FTAs in issue coverage and tariff elimination to maximize the benefits from FTAs. And as I showed you earlier, Japan's FTAs so far are not high level in terms of issue coverage and tariff elimination. In that regard, I was disappointed to hear about the sanctuary stuff, agriculture and auto in the U.S. These are the sectors in these two countries which really need structural adjustment. If we exclude them, you know, what's the purpose of having TPP? I do understand that if you exclude these, I mean, if you include these, maybe we cannot, you know, stand at the starting line, but what we need to do is not to exclude them. We should take time. You know, it may take maybe 10 years, 15 years, 30, 20 years to deal with these issues, but we cannot just simply exclude them. And I'd like to see through negotiation that they'll be included. Okay, and then Japan should prepare safety nets, like, you know, trade adjustment assistance programs in the U.S. and similar programs in Korea made it easier for at least Korea to sign or to conclude FTA. Japan doesn't have that. And I'd like to see Japan to at least look into that possibility. And then Japan should establish a body to oversee and coordinate all these FTA negotiations. We know that, you know, TPP is a big negotiation, and we have Minister Amari to take responsibility, but we need really a body which looks over the other FTAs as well. And finally, Japanese political leaders, and I'd like to see Prime Minister Abe to stick to his position on TPP and other FTA negotiations. And indeed, TPP, according to my understanding of Prime Minister Abe's three-arrow strategy, TPP is a major component of the growth strategy, and I'd like to see that to be implemented. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Urata-sensei. We also would like to post that with TPP, they won't have to pay 1,600% for konnyaku. Because there are two sides to that story, and there are a lot more consumers than farmers. Professor Lim, thank you.
Thank you. They are already provided. As always, we take the easy way out and just go to the main general outlines. But nonetheless, I think I would like to provide a perspective that may have different nuances compared to China and Japan. And I'm come from Singapore, but I would provide the ASEAN 10 countries perspective. The outlines of my papers is on the new developments in the Asia-Pacific Economic Integration Trans-Pacific Partnership from the ASEAN perspectives. To some extent also the Singapore perspective. The second is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP, which I think the two previous speakers have not given some of the inside track of the ASEAN perspectives. The third one is a China-Japan-Korea FTA, and the last one, in a way, is a policy conclusions on ASEAN perspective on TPP and CJK FTA. The Trans-Pacific Partnerships has concluded 16 rounds. In fact, actually, now I think it's going on from 14 to 25 in Lima, Peru. So the 17th round is being held now in Lima, Peru, in May 2013. The current goal is to reach an agreement in time for the October 2013 APEC summit in Bali in October. For the deadline to be achieved, outstanding negotiating positions need to be tabled soon in order for political decision to be made. The consensus in ASEAN countries, some ASEAN countries have a different slight timeline, but I think it's not possible to be signed, at least based on the Honolulu leaders' APEC general guidelines. Decisions on key market access, such as dairy, sugar, and textile, and apparel, may be dependent on the outcome of controversial rules negotiations, such as IPR and state-owned enterprises. I'm saying here, I'm emphasizing the ASEAN perspectives. 21 chapters in the agreement are under discussion. The US is negotiating market access for goods, services, and agriculture with countries with which it does not currently have FTAs: Brunei, Darussalam, Malaysia, New Zealand, and Vietnam. In fact, actually, the US has only with Singapore FTA, and the US wants to use the template of Singapore US FTA to be concluding with the other ASEAN partner, but it fails. Negotiations are also being conducted on discipline to IPR, trade in services, government procurement, investment, rules of origin, competition, labor, environmental standards, and other issues. Most of those disciplines, I think, should not be a problem, except that government procurement, because of the, in Malaysia particularly, and also in Vietnam, because of the socialist economic structures in Vietnam, because of the Bumiputra policies. But in Singapore, also the SOEs, a lot of the productive service, productive capacities are owned by the state, but not managed by the state. So it's a different shades of rules. The labor issues and the labor issues more than anything else probably also would pose problems in many then ASEAN member countries. When the senator mentioned it, I think I'm a bit concerned that this could be a posed problem. Some topics such as state-owned enterprises, regulatory coherence, and supply chains competitiveness break new ground on FTA negotiations. I think these are not an issue for ASEAN. Perspective of major economies, the United States perspective. The TPP, serving strategic goals of US trade policy, is a leading trade policy initiative of the Obama administration, as well as major manifestation of the administration pivot to Asia. In fact, actually, I think, in my personal view, it has to be moderated and toned. That's why China oppositions and many interpretation of TPP, because it is sold, or it was initiated as a US pivot. It's not only just on trade, not on economics, but on securities. So China set an alarm. So I think somehow need to be, in fact, actually, I agree with Ishige-san that I think it is good economically for China. It should be interpreted as the second time around for China to be just like in the 2001 December admission, accession to the WTO. But the tone and the emphasis, the focus has to be changed, and it must come from the United States. If concluded, TPP may serve to shape the economic architecture of Asia-Pacific region by harmonizing existing agreements with US FTA partners, attracting new participants, and establishing regional rules on new policy issues facing the global economy, possibly providing impetus to future multilateral liberalization under the WTO. I think this part of it is also the US has to moderate it. It's so much like 21st century standards, high standards, comprehensive, all those things. Those areas are not a problem, in my views, an ASEAN view from China. The issue of it is somehow if leadership, strategic, and non-economic issues. that somehow embodied in the U.S. TPP policy up to date. The China perspective. TPP is considered as the U.S. trade policy and strategic objective to discipline China's economic and strategic interests and influence in Asia and having the element to contain. This is the unfortunate part of it, which economic and military rise and its leadership role in East Asia regional economic integration, which, in my view, ASEAN countries does not subscribe to it. Some do, but generally, I would say the tone is not. Okay, so somehow the U.S. has to moderate TPP is not what it was sold or marketed in the initial stage. China frequently suggests that the numerous provisions of the TPP are designed to make it difficult for China to participate and actually aim to achieve the goal of excluding China, which I don't think it is the case. And many ASEAN countries do not believe such. But it has been sold or marketed in such a platform, unfortunately, despite the Obama administration declared policy intention that the promotion of TPP is designed to apply pressure on China to follow the rules of international trade. Well, I think this part of it, Professor Zhang has mentioned it, but I generally agree with it. But the tone from the ASEAN 10 countries is that it is not what China perceives, but it is for domestic consumption in China itself. Therefore, China vigorously supports ASEAN-initiated regional comprehensive economic partnership and China-Japan-Korea FTA as China can achieve its twin objective of East Asia regional economic integration without confronting the U.S. directly and achieve East Asia economic integration to RCEP. So in a sense that my personal view, and shared by many ASEAN scholars and analysts, is that China also on their part project and conceptualize that the TPP is a U.S. design to do all these sort of things that they intend to do harm and negative to China. But it's but actually China also as a rising emerging power, superpower, would like to have its leadership. So by initially accepting automatically the TPP, not on the economic contents, but on the others, China, in a sense, relegated its leadership role in its neighborhood. China also accord high trade policy priority to promote China-Japan-Korea FTA. Realistically, China-Korea FTA would be concluded first as South Korea has already an FTA with U.S. and therefore having less external pressure from the U.S. The negotiation process of CJK is complicated as China and Japan have to delicately balance and manage their domestic politics due to heightened territorial dispute in East China Sea. But nonetheless, I think China very strongly support the CJK FTA. TPP is interpreted as divisive to East Asia economic integration as China, Korea, and India, Indonesia are not part of TPP negotiating countries. Indonesia, I could say also, is not in favor at this point of joining TPP, but concentrating on the ASEAN economic communities and the RCEP. Japan perspective, Prime Minister Abe announced that Japan will enter TPP negotiating round. However, it is unclear when Japan will be able to join the negotiations. Is it in the 17th round scheduled in Lima, Peru, which is or beyond? A lot of people in ASEAN would think that the next round would be in Malaysia in August, but not sure yet whether Japan would be able to do it because of the 3 months notifications timeline. In entering the TPP negotiation, the Abe administration does not have a full consensus among ruling coalition parties, as the agriculture issue are important to LDP political constituency. I tend to agree with my colleague, Professor Urata. I think it has been overblown, by Japan. So the differences, disparities are not that big as generally understood and marketed in Japan. Japan is strongly negotiating ASEAN initiative, RCEP, and has agreed to start negotiation with China and Korea on CJKFTA. It is to be seen how Japan would balance its trade policy priority between TPP, RCEP, and CJKFTA. I have to go through quickly because the monitor is seeing more minutes. Very difficult. Joining the TTP negotiation is very important economic and political decision as Japan is embarking a major economic restructuring and revitalization of its decade-long slow growth economic trajectory. Japan's commitment in TPP can be a catalyst to a much-needed domestic economic reform. I think in most ASEAN countries, they support, particularly Singapore, of the Japan decision to join the TPP. At the same time, supporting RCEP is also important as Japan supports strongly ASEAN economic integration and East Asia through comprehensive economic partnership, CPIA, which now takes the form of RCEP. So RCEP is conceptually an amalgam or integrations of China support EFTA, East Asia FTA, and CPIA, Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement under the East Asia Summit's framework. China and South Korea are very important economically to Japan as the three major economies constitute more than 70% of East Asia GDP, and there is enormous potential to benefit from economic integration through CJK. China, Japan, and South Korea have officially agreed to start negotiations in 2003. Now, the last part of it is the RCEP, the U.S. perspective. This is, again, from my personal perspective from Southeast Asia. The U.S. is not interested to participate in ASEAN-led RCEP as it's considered not comprehensive and high-standard FTA. And this also, this branding need to be moderated, in my views. It somehow works the opposite direction to the U.S. interest. The broad political and business spectrum in the U.S. is solely interested in pursuing TPP as it anchors U.S. economic, political, strategic objectives through the full extent of TPP 29 chapters under negotiation. And again, this is again the focal point of the U.S., which I think should be again toned down to the benefit of U.S. and aligning convergence between TPP and RCEP. As a super military and economic power, the U.S. is accustomed to be a leader and not a follower in any major international regional negotiations. Now, China perspective. China has strongly endorsed RCEP as it fits extremely well with China economic and strategic objective in East Asia. It doesn't mean that China against the TPP, just purely from the economic contents, but others are the securities and non-economic contents that probably, and also to fit the Chinese domestic politics. And the China very much, at this point, opposes the TPP. ASEAN-initiated RCEP is based on the concept of ASEAN centrality. So China, again and again, every opportunity, reaffirms its commitment to ASEAN centralities. So default hub. At this stage of development, China may feel more comfortable that East Asia economic integration is managed through ASEAN. You can ask these issues. I don't have the details, but I have quite a number of strong points on this issue. The conclusion of RCEP negotiation is scheduled at end of 2015, coinciding with the completion of the ASEAN Economic Community objective of single market and production base. So it is necessary that in order to to complete RCEP, not in the total complete form, but probably in a stage, just like mentioned it by Professor Urata and Professor Zhang. But I think it will be concluded. The conclusion of RCEP could be delayed, but the RCEP completed date does not matter to China as much as it is to ASEAN. ASEAN is take it very seriously. Now, how about the Japan perspective? Japan has also strongly endorsed RCEP as the objective of RCEP fits to its national objective as ASEAN provides the width and breadth of Japan economic and strategic space in view of the rising of China. Japan will facilitate the process of RCEP negotiation through a more flexible negotiation by focusing more on trade and investment facilitation and economic cooperation aspect of RCEP. So when it deals with RCEP, trade cooperation, economic trade facilitation, economic cooperation, and deal with, because RCEP is not only just trade liberalization, but economic development and community building, which there is no such element in the TPP. The inclusion of India, Australia, New Zealand is also augur well for Japan's broad trade policy in Asia-Pacific region. Japan would adopt a two-track trade policy by joining TPP and RCEP negotiations simultaneously. TPP is considered as having upper bias and RCEP as downward bias mode of economic integration. At this point, it is difficult to conceptualize the convergence of TPP and RCEP process, particularly because TPP, the outcomes and the details are not open to public. And I support the Ishige-san's and Professor Urata's suggestion to be more coordinations in order to provide a certain convergence. China-Japan-Korea FTA, the last point, is the priority of the U.S. trade policy in Asia-Pacific is to complete the TPP successfully. This would serve the U.S. objective for APEC-led FTA-AP, which I'm not very sure that U.S. really going toward that point, and probably the template for the multilateral trade negotiation. Also, I'm not very sure on that point. So the TPP is the cornerstone of the U.S. trade policy and the embodiment of the broad strategic interest in the Asia-Pacific region. I think U.S. should focus more on the economic contents of TPP rather than the broad strategic interest, which alarm China and use that for its domestic politics. The conclusion of CJK would sidetrack the U.S. of its increasingly vital linkage to East Asia economic dynamism. On China perspective, would be a vital strategy to dock in with ASEAN-led RCEP and Asia Economic Community to complete East Asia economic integration. Because Southeast Asia has already AEC, ASEAN Economic Community. Northeast Asia, CJK, China, Japan, Korea doesn't have that framework. So realistically, China expects to complete CJK first before progressing wider towards CJK as Japan is under pressure domestically and regionally to give priority to TPP first. Despite China's territorial dispute with Japan, there is a wide consensus to proceed and complete CJK trade negotiation. However, the reciprocal sentiment is not clear on CJK in Japan. But I heard from Ishige-san's that Japan also strongly support the conclusion, the negotiations of that issue. Just a little bit, few more here. Japan is officially agreed to start trade negotiation on CJK. The issue is the structure, the scope, the time, and the speed of the CJK negotiation because you have to balance with the TPP and the RCEP. Probably this part of it is, I should look at the ASEAN perspective on TPP and CJK, because I don't have the time. ASEAN policy focus is to complete the ASEAN Economic Community by 2015. At the 20th ASEAN Summit in April 13 in Bandar Seri Begawan, Brunei, ASEAN leaders agreed to start RCEP negotiation in May, in fact, actually started on the 9th of May, in fact, actually still progressing at this point. On TPP, there is no collective policy consensus. Singapore, Brunei, Malaysia, and Vietnam are in TPP negotiation. So there is no leader, in fact, actually, outwardly, publicly announced what's sort of a position ASEAN should take on TPP. Indonesia is the key ASEAN member state which has no intention to join TPP so far, while Thailand and the Philippines are not clear of their official position on TPP. Although Thailand has indicated its interest in TPP when President Obama visited Thailand late last year because Prime Minister Yingluck did not have anything to say to President Obama. But my view is Thailand is taking its time. Thailand's main priority is to concentrate on the CMLVs, the Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, Laos, and connecting to Myanmar, Obama, and with India. And of course, with the ASEAN economic community. The completion of CJK-FTA is conceptually important for the overall East Asia economic integration, as it would facilitate ASEP trade negotiation and dock in with the ASEAN Economic Community. There is no exception. All ASEAN 10 countries support the CJK-FTA. If the ASEAN Economic Community and ASEP are successfully completed as scheduled by 2015, they would enhance the concept of ASEAN centrality. The AEC is progressing well, and the way forward for ASEP negotiations is to integrate the ASEAN plus one FTA with China, Japan, South Korea, India, Australia, and New Zealand, as there are many common elements that can be cobbled together through common tariffs, non-tariff barrier, cumulative rules of origin, trade in services, investment, trade facilitation, MRA, and other chapters. So those are the main points of my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Lim. We'll turn now to Scott Miller from CSIS to give the comments and the U.S. perspective.
Thank you. I'll since it's I'm the only thing between you and the break, I'll save time by not waddling to the platform. I'll stay right here. In any case, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I'd ask you first and foremost to heed Dr. Zhang's advice, which is don't overestimate the IQ or ability of the American on the panel here. I'll make three quick points and look forward to your questions and comments afterwards. First, it's a point about convergence in East Asia and in the Asia Pacific. You've seen an excellent overview of, which includes sort of an inventory of the whole trade policy agenda in the Asia Pacific. It is impressive. There's a lot of variation in scope and coverage, and there's no question there's a noodle bowl, but there's a lot of activity going on. The important issue to my mind is not the fact that there's a noodle bowl now and there's a lot of complexity. It's what's on the menu in 10 or 15 years. And how do we help guide the process as interested parties, not as the United States or any individual country, but get to the place that we leave a more satisfactory commercial environment for our citizens? That's why I think the architecture of the next 20 years is an important thing to consider now. To make my point, I'd ask you to look back 20 years. 20 years ago this summer was a very active summer in Washington for trade policy. We were debating the NAFTA. And the NAFTA was a breakthrough agreement in its scope and coverage and complexity, and it dealt with a tremendous number of issues. It was world class at the time, and the negotiators and the did a wonderful job negotiating it. The Congress wisely approved it. And while NAFTA was a great success, if you go back 20 years ago to the files from places like CSIS and other think tanks, all the arguments were about essentially demand side issues. We were engaging in this free trade agreement to sell things to each other, okay, to get achieve market access, to do the kinds of things. Today, NAFTA is probably more important than it was 20 years ago, but selling things to each other, the demand side, is the least important part of NAFTA. What we use NAFTA for today, the three parties, Mexico, Canada, the United States, is we make things together. What's happened is a massive evolution in IT-enabled global supply networks. Those supply networks take place every day beneath our feet in North America. And so we've reached the point now where excluding energy, which is a major traded commodity among the three parties, but take energy out of the equation, the typical Canadian export to the United States and the typical Mexican export to the United States both have more than 40% U.S. content when they cross the border. That's the degree of trade in components and trade that was unexpected at the time of NAFTA, in fact, unplanned for. So this brings me to make a point that there's a policy and a practical approach to this. The policy approach was articulated, and I want to make sure Ishige-san gets credit for this, because he basically talked in his presentation about the policy argument for a new quad. Sorry, Canada, but it's the U.S., the European Union, Japan, and China, who on a policy level, at the trade minister level, ought to be talking about this architecture, talking about not where things are now, but where things are going. And I think it's a provocative and important recommendation and an opportunity for real creativity. I would add there's a practical dimension to this as well. The practical dimension is right before our negotiating partners, in that by my count, including Japan as a TPP partner, 7 of the 12, so a majority of TPP negotiating partners, are also negotiating RCEP. okay? Japan, Singapore, New Zealand, Brunei, Australia, Malaysia, Vietnam. All right. So there is a majority of parties at the table doing things like talking about customs administration and agreeing to disciplines in let's just take that chapter, customs administration in TPP, who ought to have no interest in a different set of obligations in RCEP. In fact, there ought to be strong pressure for the same set of obligations. To the extent that that can happen beyond customs procedures and in through the broader text of RCEP and TPP, the convergence will help us decide what's on the menu in 20 years and not be worrying about the noodle bowl. So I think this is entirely possible. I think my colleague from Singapore will ensure his government does this. And Frank, this is sort of Singapore's core business if you look at the way the country operates and where its success comes from. But the other six parties to the TPP who are also parties to RCEP should think about this from a negotiating standpoint and work very practically to solve the problems that could be solved now. Second point I'd make is about economic growth and the needs that the United States and Japan both have for economic growth and the fact that we need each other to press for reforms in both economies. Now look, the United States situation is very simple as I see it from Washington. First, we're all out of fiscal stimulus, okay? We did an omnibus stimulus package in 2009. All the budget talk in Washington these days is about cutting spending, not increasing spending. We're in the world of sequesters. Fiscal stimulus is not a way to get our economy growing. Second, monetary policy. My compliments to Chairman Bernanke and the Federal Reserve Board for keeping the economy out of a second recession, but quantitative easing has reached its practical limits, and in fact, most of the talk, if you read yesterday's Wall Street Journal, was about when quantitative easing stops, when the monetary easing comes to an end, not how to do it more or how to get more out of quantitative easing. So without that, what's left on the policy agenda? Well, for me, opening markets is always a good solution, both because opening markets abroad helps increase the competitiveness and the performance of globally engaged American companies, which represent 23% of our economy and the most productive capacity building elements of our economy are globally engaged companies, but also reform to our domestic economy, which helps consumers and helps adopt reforms that we need to do anyway, but our trading partners can ask us. Here's the opportunity of the TPP with Japan included. All of a sudden, unlike the old P4 that we joined in 2006 or 2007, TPP now contains three of our five largest trading partners. And big trading partners can ask the United States to do things that small ones can't. Okay, I'm always, you know, one of the things I nag constantly about is dairy reform. I think our dairy programs badly need to be reformed. I always realize this when I travel to Costa Rica or Panama and I look on the restaurant table and there's New Zealand butter on the table. And knowing we have free trade agreements, but New Zealand can deliver the butter more efficiently than American farmers can, irritates me. So I know there's room for reform in our economy. The issue is New Zealand's not big enough to ask us to reform our dairy industry and for us to say yes. Here's the thing. Here's the power of TPP with Japan, Canada, Mexico involved. Those economies are big, important trading partners of the United States. They can ask us to undertake reform that we're likely to do. So finally, let me address the issue of sensitivities, which is always a big topic in trade agreements. Look, let me acknowledge, first of all, that every economy has sensitivities. What I would like to say is, first, you have to keep the sensitivities in context, and second, sensitive sectors aren't. Keeping the sensitive sectors sensitivities in context is there's a bigger gain to be for the citizens by reforming the economy, and reform is difficult and requires political courage, but it's that economic reform that produces the growth onward. I'm glad that the members of Congress, the Clinton White House and the negotiators who negotiated NAFTA took on sensitive sectors then to open up the North American market. I think Americans are better off. I think citizens are better off in all three countries. That can be achieved. It's important as we consider sensitivities that we not get stuck in one another's talking points. My personal blood pressure goes up when I see food security referred to in the context of agriculture protection. I would note that here today, the person from the country with the greatest level of food security is my colleague from Singapore. Singapore grows nothing but orchids, okay, and has tremendous food security. Eggs. I forgot about eggs. Okay. In any case, the place has incredible food security with open markets. On the other hand, the country in the Asia Pacific that is most focused on a real policy of food security is North Korea. How's that working out? In any case, let me get to my final comment on. Sensitive sectors aren't. There are sensitivities. There are sensitive companies, sensitive products. But sectors as a whole usually have a broad range of competitors involved, some of whom are truly exposed to import competition and need some effort expended to address that exposure to import competition for the sake of the workers and the sake of the business. There are also globally competitive companies in every sector, and even in Senator Cardin mentioned textiles and apparel. It will be a sensitive sector for the United States, but the whole sector is not sensitive. Talk to Sara Lee and companies that are, Hanes Brands, the companies that are globally engaged in global supply networks and moved in the modern world. There's no question there are import competing industries, but the policy ought to be not to protect the import competing industries and by protecting the whole sector, but rather by moving the architecture of the agreement that addresses the modernization needs and moves the whole industry toward a more competitive, more sustainable future. This was true in autos in Korea. At the same time as you had one American auto company headquartered in Dearborn raising great concerns about the Korean market, you had another American auto company headquartered in downtown Detroit, which had a 19% share of the Korean market. All right, there's some diversity there. That's not a sensitive sector. There are sensitivities. And making that distinction, I think, is helpful to all of us because it will help our negotiators have the imagination to bring the real reform that is potential that has we have the potential of achieving through the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Mike, and we look forward to your comments after the break.